Danny, you have to make me cry.
Oh, my.
That's Danny Paul, and he's sitting at my table. And he is a friend, and he is somebody that is in the Hall of Fame. Don Harden's got it exactly right. You don't get it right until you recognize that he's a Hall of Fame coach, too. And having won so many track titles, so many cross-country titles, that expands that resume. So, Don, we talked about that. That there are some of these folks that if you put them in a little too soon, you've got to go back and you've got to add to it. That's Danny Paul, and I'm so honored to have him at my table. Also, at my table today, reminding me that it didn't matter that I described myself over and over and over the years as a middle of a packer. And then I started to say, well, maybe I'm at the front of the middle of the pack. I knew who I was as a runner, but at my table, who nominated me for this honor is Larry Allen, who has been a friend for a very, very long time. And Larry Allen is the one, when I was serving on the board, who came to me and said, you know what would be a really great idea, Ed, is if we started recognizing some of those great races. That was Larry Allen's idea. I took it to the board. We started with the Bangor Labor Day race and the Portland Boys Club race. Tour de Lac was an important one for me because I still describe this as the quintessential Maine race because it's brutal. It's hill after hill after hill. And so it was Larry Allen's idea. He nominated me, sitting at Garrett's table. It was Mike Westfall, who has been a very, very dear friend for a very, very long time. And he joined in on that. And what could be better honor than to have both of those individuals in your corner? I was scared to death that you people would think I'd write my own biography, so I'm really grateful to John Rolfe for stepping in and writing that. So no, I didn't write my biography. I'm grateful to those people. Also at my table is Robin Emery, who doesn't want me to talk about her, so I won't. Okay, Robin. Thank you for coming. At my table is my godson, Joseph Poshi, and his mom, Bada. And thank you for coming. You mean more to me than I have words. At my table is my wife, Susan, who I not only love, but she inspires me every day. At my table is O.J. Logue, who is one of the very, very special people in Maine running. And I just want to express my gratitude because not here today, and part of the reason why I'm emotional, and this is Veterans Day, and I'll be respectful to the memories, but I'm sort of imagining what this would be like if my mom, who served in World War II, was a wave. My dad, who was in the Pacific theater at Midway. My younger brother, who didn't survive, this world was just a little too tough for him. What would they think? Ed in a Hall of Fame? Dear God, I don't know. But, their memories are very, very special, and I'd like to imagine that they'd be happy to join me here. Also, this friend from high school. And Susan knows that this is probably gonna be tough for me because I had to speak at his memorial service, and there's nothing harder than that. And Mike Swenson was the number one runner at Bangor High School in 1966 before I could wipe my nose. And he was an inspiration to me. And dear Mike, in his latter stages, we would go to restaurants. And so I pick him up and then I drive him and he'd daughter back, and then he would turn and he'd salute me. And so Mike, dear brother, that's for you. So there are these people that are so special to me and I'm thinking of them. And so now we get to the point of what the hell am I doing here? I think of that Woody Allen line. There's a character, he opens the film, it's Annie Hall, and he's looking right into the camera and he says, I'd never want to be a member of a club or an organization, maybe I'll add the Running Hall of Fame, that would have a member like me. And so, yeah, here's to us middle of the packers out here who did that. So if I address what it was that running did for me, I'm coming from a perspective of the middle of the pack, and the thing that I think about more than anything is that how many of these wonderful runners motivated me because when I first got there, I thought of myself as being mediocre. And so there is Steve the Silver Fox Norton, who was the secret coach for Jerry Clapper. And I ran day after day at the field house at the University of Maine. Steve was just bringing me along, and then turning me loose. And then I discovered something that, as I used to tell my students, and I hope everybody in here thinks about this, that we don't have to sit and watch television and, you know, vicariously live through those athletes. I started to tell my students, you know who my favorite athlete is? Me. I'm starting to discover right now how much fun it is to go out and make my own memories and be the runner I can be. So I'm here because of three people, and they're all long past. We'll start with Andrew Sokolexis. I thought it was important to write a biography of this forgotten Maine runner. What did I learn on that journey? What I learned is that we do an injustice to the runners of the 40s and the 50s and much earlier, when we just think, well, you know, we're so much better than they were. The line I'd like to leave you with is, a great runner would be a great runner in any era. And that's the tribute I'll pay to Andrew Sokolexis. The second person that I'm clearly here for is a young man named Terry Fox. So, show of hands, how many of you are familiar with the name Terry Fox and you actually admire him? Okay. And that's fine if you haven't, because I understand it. The story all started in the 1980s when a young man who had suffered cancer, and they took his good leg away from him, and he got on a prosthesis and he tried to run across Canada. And my story ties with his in a way that I don't have words to express. It ties to his because in the summer of 1980, I was setting PRs. And I'd never run like that in my life. And I had a brand new job, and I was the editor of a magazine. And my life was golden. And then in the fall, it crashed. And it crashed in a way that I never could have imagined. I'd never not succeeded. And now I was out of work. I had a marriage that didn't make a hell of a lot of sense to me. And then my running fell apart because I had an ailment in my leg and no one could tell me what it was. And I started to envision killing a man. I started to think day in and day out about going over and killing a man. And I know in this climate, in this day and place, what that sounds like to all of you, and it should. And it scared me, because I'm not capable of that. I needed a way to find something. And I found it in this young Canadian, because for once I was reading about and seeing somebody who was real, that what he was doing mattered to him, and he was as altruistic as it could be. And so I watched, and then I learned he was dying of the very cancer that had taken his leg. And so I went to people like Larry Allen and I said, can't we do this? Can't we put on one tribute run in 1982 and just celebrate this very special life, because he's helped me regain my equilibrium. I'm back on my feet, I'm running now, I've got a new job, I'm editing a newspaper, I'm fine now. This kid's dead and we need to remember what he was about, what he did. And I could not believe what happened after that. Larry said to me, Ed, when you put on a first time run, you'll have about 75 to 100 runners. But I was thinking to myself, no, we won't. Because I'm going to go to the media and I'm going to talk about this and we're going to attract people who are battling cancer and we're going to do something real special. And so Mike Westfall a few years ago said something to me I hadn't really thought. He said, Ed, do you know, I think the Terry Fox Run may have been Maine's first annual charity run. And I didn't know about that. I looked up some of the others to see if that was possible. Is that true? And it may well be. It's certainly in the argument. And so I'm going to make an appeal today for an event, a run to be honored. That Terry Fox Run lasted 20 years in Bangor. And so many people, Bob Coughlin, I started to cry, I didn't know he'd passed. Bob Coughlin put on the first Terry Fox Run in Portland. 1982, and I'll be grateful to him forever. You can keep waving that at me. I've got a couple more things to say. I'm the one that got to go last. And I do have a couple of people to pay tribute to, and they're not here anymore, and I'm going to do this respectfully. Terry Fox gave his life to something, and he inspired me, and now I'm going to tell you a very brief story on the other end of this. Why should you honor the Terry Fox Run? Well, I could probably suggest that I'm probably responsible for why you can't get sponsorship for a 10K, a half marathon, or anything else longer, because everybody wants to have that run like that Rice guy's got, where over 400 people are showing up. That's what we discovered in the Bangor area. We couldn't get sponsorships for longer distances. Everybody wanted to put on a run just like that one. And what's the legacy? There is the Lafayette Family Cancer Clinic in Brewer, Maine now, put on by Danny and Carla Lafayette. They picked up the sponsorship of the Terry Fox Run in 1994, and they put it on and kept it going until 2002. A couple of years ago, Susan and I were privileged to go to the event that the Lafayettes put on annually to try to raise money. And a young woman came up to Susan and I and said, Ed, I bet you'd like to have a tour of this cancer clinic. It's locked up right now, but you deserve to have a chance to see it. Her name is Jennifer, and she's one of the volunteers there. Jennifer beat breast cancer. She and a friend of hers had the same diagnosis, and it was dire. It was, you are not going to survive this. And her friend went with a traditional protocol, and it failed. Jennifer opted for a non-traditional, and she beat it. And as she was taking us around in tears, and I was crying, and showing us all the different wings of that are now supported, that people have donated, and then she said the thing to me that says to me the Terry Fox Run deserves to be honored. She said, do you know that people from Central and Northern Maine, if they don't have health insurance, if they don't have the wherewithal to pay for this, they can come to this clinic for free. That's the legacy of the Terry Fox Run, and I'm very proud of it, and will be forever. Thank you, Larry, for all the support in the early years. Thank you, Michael, for telling me about that. The other friend that I'm here representing is an angel, and her name is Jenny Delvecchio, and some of you will read all of the details that are in there. But Terry Fox, in that incident, prepared me to be a better person than I'd ever been in my entire life. And now when I, as the editor of the Winchester Town Crier, meet a woman who is dying of Lou Gehrig's disease, and she has said, you're the only editor. She's typed this out because she's lost the ability to speak. She has said to me, you're the only editor I want to talk to and tell you my story. She had lost her mother and her brother simultaneously. How many of you are familiar with ALS, Lou Gehrig's disease? How many of you with your hands up actually have had it impact you? You're not just doing the bucket challenge, you've actually known somebody. Yeah, it was an orphan disease in 1994. Doctors didn't even know how to diagnose it. It was a whole different matter. But I was privileged to meet this incredible woman, and together we did amazing things. And thanks to Kim Moody, who had inspired me to learn how to run ultra, I could start to think in terms of maybe running across Massachusetts to raise awareness, to raise some and raise funds for Dr. Robert H. Brown, who's the only man in the world who's actually uncovered a familial gene for ALS. And that's the kind of research that's going on now with ALS. And I'm just honored to death to think that maybe an angel named Ginny is looking down and her runner boy is still here, still cares. And that is probably the other thing. So finally, you've all maybe noticed that I started with Bob Payne, going all the way back to the inception of the idea of having a Maine Running Hall of Fame. And then I served on that very, very first board and watched it get started. And then a very dear friend of Danny's, mine, and others in this room, Dr. Peter Millar, became the head of the board. I guess he's angry that I'm going over. I'm sorry, I'm gonna finish up shortly. This is actually an appeal that hopefully Don and Chandra and the others would like to hear today. This is an appeal to support the Maine Running Hall of Fame. Dr. Peter Millard asked me, would I take a look at the 60 biographies that they currently have. Now, this was a task for an editor. We won't mention names, but the longest one was 7.5 pages long. The shortest one was under 2 pages. I am going to tell you who the person is that was under 2 pages. Joan Benoit Samuelson. I actually stretched Joni's, because I thought, we're going to shoot for 2 to 2.5 pages for these. And you know what she was doing? The person who did it for her, they did what I used to tell my students was the train sentence. You have 2 or 3 concepts, comma, right, Danny? Comma, here's the idea, here's the idea, here's the idea. And Joni had like 3 of them that if you just set aside the one individual one, you'd say, wow, that's a paragraph all by itself. No problem to get hers to conform to the 2 pages. And so the idea of having the pictures and the photographs and everything, I put some time and effort into it, and I love seeing that that tradition is continuing. Some of us in this room could have a real interesting conversation about the idea of, do we elect people sooner, before their careers are over? I'd like to be on the side of the wall that says, no, let's let them have complete careers. Some of us are talking about, should a woman go in every time, frankly? Now you may want to throw something at me. I think it's demeaning to women any more than it would be to men. When you have a particular election that comes along and nobody goes in, that's fine. You set your standards. That's why I set my standards for, do I belong here? I'm not sure I do. I'm not Dick Goody. I'm not Dale Lincoln. I'm not the late Fred Merriam. I know, and that was my standard for looking at the kinds of people that belong and who doesn't. But you may have a different set of standards. I am not casting aspersions on anyone selected to hear, but I set the individual standards that I believed in. If you're sitting out there, don't be thinking, oh, I'll let somebody else do this. We need other people to join the board and become involved and represent the entire state. Because this is a wonderful, wonderful organization. I am so fortunate to be standing here today, and I hope you recognize that I am deeply honored. And indeed, I don't think I deserve the honor. But support the Maine Running Hall of Fame. We all need to do it, and thank you, Maine Running Hall of Fame, and thank you, your beautiful Bobby Speaks today.